Okay, well, again, welcome now to the user meeting part. So one of the goals of this conference is to have a conference that is integrated with the user meeting of CSCS. And I would like, on my part, also to thank or follow Petros, who, in thanking Olaf, Andreas, Michele, and Maria Grazia for the great job they did in really pulling this together and organizing this conference. Thank you. So last user meeting or user assembly in Lucerne in September last year, I announced the machine that we were going to build in the final details. And we didn't talk about the size at the time, but it turns out to be one of the couple of large systems, along with the one in Jülich that we have in Europe. And it is a very energy efficient system. So it is among all the petascale systems in the world, according to a number of metrics that you can apply, the most energy efficient. And this turned out to be the most important feature, because ETH has to pay the power bill. And so since we undercut the power estimates, the CFO of ETH is now, I'm a better friend of the CFO than I was before, when he was worried about the amount of money we would spend. But this is generally important in Switzerland to show that we can do more with less electrical energy. This is very important politically and so on. So we have to take this seriously, and I will come back to this. I won't talk about the system. Sadaf will later give you all the details, gory details about the hardware and how it is managed. I just want to review the history in order to explain how we move forward and how co-design and the things we do inside of PASC are really central to what we are doing in the future at CSCS. So the system started off in December 2012 with the installation of first 12 cabinets. And in parallel to this initial procurement and development, we also engaged in a detailed evaluation of whether the system should be just a distributed multicore, so with two Xeons, or one with Xeon and Xeon Phi accelerator, or one with Xeon GPU. You know the answer that we ended up with, but I want to reiterate that this was after we had studied this for a year. And I want to highlight also at this point, so all the application developers that are, many of them sit in this room, and in the end, helping to make the decision, a crucial contribution came from Thorsten Höfler, who helped us really understand some of the deficiencies of some of the processors that we were looking at. And that's really a very good collaboration that I would like to highlight as well. Then we had codes that were used to basically help design the system. And in the last phase, we actually picked two codes, CP2K and Cosmo, and co-developed the codes with the system. And so that you can call this an early stage of co-design or whatever you want, but it turned out to be very important to take, you know, non-HPL-like, everybody designs for HPL, but codes that like CP2K stress the network, or Cosmo stress the memory bandwidth, and try to come up with a system that is balanced for all these applications. And then we installed the cabinets. You know the history. It was accepted in record time and with a rigorous acceptance. And that in itself is a story and an experience. How do you debug a system that has 5,000 GPUs in it? But we were, I think, successful in the end. And the NVIDIA guys are smiling. But and we had early science running since April, January, and the system is now fully in operation. Okay. this is one of the two codes. I'm not going to go into details on CP2K for various reasons, but they have very interesting results there. This is just to give you a feeling for the improvement that has been going on. So maybe some of you have seen this movie in the climate session. It may have been showed yesterday. But what I tried to show, this is a 2 kilometer resolution simulation of a storm system over Europe. This shows you the domain with the same resolution that would run today still on Monte Rosa, using the existing COSMO code. Okay? And this domain, the same resolution, the same, roughly the same number of nodes, same time to solution, but much bigger domain. The area is about an order of magnitude different. So you can say it's roughly an order of magnitude is the step from Monte Rosa and an existing code and the this co-developed code and computer system. Now, to make it more quantitative, I know I showed this in September. Maybe it's good to repeat it for those who don't remember. This is now taking the same code, the current COSMO code, blue, the blue code, running on Monte Rosa, running the COSMO 2. Again, 2 kilometer, the production problem of Meteo Suisse, but is very similar in terms of time to solution requirements as the climate problems that run on these systems. And so this code, you take the code that has been optimized for multicores and you run it on the Sandy Bridge versus the Interlagos, you see an improvement in time to solution, about 1.35. Now you take the same problem, same number of cores, same resolution, or same number of nodes, and you move it to this newly developed code that was done under HP2C, and you have a factor 1.5, roughly, improvement on both Pitstein and Monte Rosa. Then you move over the code to the GPUs. You halve the number of socket. It's still the same number of nodes. And you get factor 1.7. So overall, you get about the factor 3. Or within Monte Rosa, within Pitstein, if you take a current code and you move it to the GPUs, you get the factor 2.5 in time to solution. This is one way to look at the problem, okay? And this is not just specific to climate. It's just one example. I cannot go through 15 examples. But this is really the difference in time to solution when you just use the code and run it on the CPUs versus running it hybrid. Actually, if you run it on the CPUs in order to have the same number of CPUs as we had here, you would have to double the number of nodes. Or if you, the same node hours would give you a factor 5 in time to solution on Titan. And I would say that's an average number, you know, that you should reach. Some applications are better, some are less. But there's another side to the whole thing, and that's energy to solution. And energy to solution, so we plot here the amount of energy, kilowatt hours, we use to get a certain result on a certain resource. So just so short of 6 kilowatt hours, we move it over to Pitstein, we're at a factor 1.75 better. That's packaging, better packaging technology. We move to the new code, and there we just get out what we have in time to solution. You run for less time, using roughly the same power, then you use less energy. The significant gain comes again from involving the GPUs and the hybrid system, 2.5, which is significantly better than the improvement in time to solution. So overall, this is a factor 7, or within Pitstein, a factor 4. Okay. So if you decide to invest in applications and move them to the new architecture, you know, you should get, I would say, you know, some are better, some are worse, but roughly on average, I would say a factor 4 in energy to solution. And so I'm trying to make this as a statement why people should really invest in renewing applications and mapping them better to hardware, moving along with modern hardware in order to keep the energy thing under control. And the result in the end, economically, you can say, you know, Pit Stein is 1 to 2 megawatts today in use, and it would otherwise be, it was planned to be about 6 megawatts. Okay, and the difference is 4 million. Okay, because a megawatt is roughly 1 million a year. Okay, so that difference can be invested in other places. Okay, and now how are we doing this? And this is now really looking forward also in because we can learn from these projects in terms of how we should develop software in the future. So the Blue Code is pretty much a well-optimized monolithic Fortran code that splits into physics, dynamics, and a few other things. And then in the HP2C project, we rewrote the dynamics. We broke it up into a number of domain libraries or data structure-specific libraries. We have backends for x86, so it runs on multicore or it runs on GPU. And we have also separated the multicore, the multi-threading on a node from the issue of parallelizing over distributed memory system. And it is this type of thing that we would like to promote into the future. Okay? And now I know to most people this looks like a lot of work, and it is a lot of work. Okay? But at the same time, I think when we look at what we are really doing in computational science, we can actually learn how we have to restructure ourselves as a community as we move forward. And so what I would like to do, I know I've shown some, most of you have seen these slides, but it's really the foundation of what we are doing in the future. Namely, in anywhere in computational science, I again start with climate, but this applies to all fields. We start with some physical model we want to model. We have a mathematical description of the model, so Euler equations in this case. We have algorithms that basically discretization numerically solve these equations. We write code, we compile code, and we put it on a machine. And this is more or less the things, how things have been in computational science, the workflow since many years. The good thing about this, what I call old model of doing things, so the Blue Code I talked before was developed in this way, is that you have a clear line where you can say, okay, we scientists and mathematicians, we worry about the things here. The computer architects and computer scientists worry about the things down here, okay? And that's good. Then the world is simple, okay? And as I said, it's the same if you do quantum many-body theory. It's the same if you do molecular dynamics or any other field. It's the same structure. The problem is today we have this dilemma of many architectures, okay? And we cannot, these vectorizing, parallelizing things don't work if you have this type of diversity. Okay? And so the point is we have to rethink the workflow in computational science. I see I have some colleagues here from the math department. We can continue to debate this later. But I think today the situation is really we have up here, we don't have a linear, you know, the physicist gives the work to the mathematician who gives the work to the computer scientist. This is not how it works. It's teams that develop things together, and you have to iterate, okay? This is already a fact today. We still have to write code and run them on machines, but now depending on the architectures, this influences the implementation, and it influences the algorithms that you choose. And it's not just changing the code. It's fundamentally changing our algorithms depending on architecture. And so basically now the green line is not drawn in the right way anymore, but we have to draw differently. And an obvious way to draw a line is here, okay? And separate the part down here, which includes computer engineering, but will include more from the domain sciences and the model development, okay? And for the model development part, we should really not be working in Fortran or C anymore, but we should be working in more dynamic environments like Python or MATLAB. There's an issue that MATLAB is not open source, doesn't work on supercomputers, but Python, we can make that work, okay? And I really, this is one of the pushes that will come, at least from our side and from the PASC co-design projects, is to move the community away from these monolithic monsters of codes, okay, that we don't understand how they work anymore. Now, below this, it's more complicated. Okay, I'm cautious, I draw a dotted line here because I don't really understand how to draw this at this point. But obviously there is going to be somewhere a separation again of concerns. But this is where we need what we call co-design. Basically, we need tools on top of which a dynamic environment lives, and these tools have to be developed again in interdisciplinary teams, but at a much lower level. And this is where the PASC co-design projects are going to invest in the coming years. And so if we do this well and we go back to COSMO, I'm pushing that community, but I will push other communities like plasma physics and a number of people who are in this room towards leaving these monolithic codes. And in 5 years, it would be nice if these climate models would be written, the top would be written in these dynamic environments. We have, you know, C++ or maybe Fortran codes down here, but it's all built on a hierarchical set of tools. In terms of the systems development, so this is basically giving you the context of where we will push. I've been pushing certain things that led to DIND. I think we know how to build systems and we will continue to do that. But in terms of how we program these machines, we really have to work together to do things differently because it's not sustainable the way we do it now. I also think, and this is a discussion with computer science and exascale and everything, I think if you take this point of view, it also becomes easier to introduce new programming models and new architectures and allows the community to be nimble as we develop towards exascale. In terms of systems at CSIS, I know many of you are interested to hear this. All I can say is not much will change other than keeping the systems growing. We had Monte Rosa that was introduced in 2009. We had HP2C that we introduced again in 2010. We had HP2C work projects that influenced the upgrade of Monte Rosa that we did in 2011. We also had this project influence the development of PitStyNT, as I said, up to now. We now have PASC, this program that runs through the end of 2016 or into 2017. You usually can carry over the funding for maybe another 6 months. And we will have PASC influence these co-design projects here is what we are going to work with to design the upgrade of the nodes in the 16-17 timeframe of PitStyNT. One thing I would like to stress is we are committed to extend the support or existence of multi-core systems at CSCS at least through the end of 2018. So before, I think we had the life of Monte Rosa ending in 2016. I'm not saying that the hardware will be the same, but this type of architecture, for those of you who rely on it, will continue to exist at CSCS. That definitely is the case. We have this investment since 2010 in data storage and analysis, data analytics platform. This will be continued. And of course, we're also already discussing the development of subsequent system, because at some point even PitStyNT will be old and have to be replaced. And we are discussing the continuation of the program. In fact, this is why I was not here. We had the steering committee meeting this morning about how we go about continuing PASC beyond 2017. So that's all I had to say. And I'm in time. But explain how we move forward and how co-design and the things we do inside of PASC are really central to what we are doing in the future at CSCS. So the system started off in December 2012 with the installation of first 12 cabinets. And in parallel to this initial procurement and development, we also engaged in a detailed evaluation of whether the system should be just a distributed multicore, so with two Xeons, or one with Xeon and Xeon Phi accelerator, or one with Xeon GPU. You know the answer that we ended up with, but I want to reiterate that this was after we had studied this for a year. And I want to highlight also at this point, so all the application developers that are, many of them sit in this room, and in the end, helping to make the decision, a crucial contribution came from Thorsten Höfler, who helped us really understand some of the deficiencies of some of the processors that we were looking at. And that's really a very good collaboration that I would like to highlight as well. Then we had codes that were has to pay the power bill. And so since we undercut the power estimates, the CFO of ETH is now, I'm a better friend of the CFO than I was before when he was worried about the amount of money we would spend. But this is generally important in Switzerland to show that we can do more with less electrical energy. This is very important politically and so on. So we have to take this seriously, and I will come back to this. I won't talk about the system. Sadaf will later give you all the details, gory details about the hardware and how it is managed. I just want to review the history in order to explain. Okay, well, again, welcome now to the user meeting part. So one of the goals of this conference is to have a conference that is integrated with the user meeting of CSCS, and I would like on my part also to thank or follow Petros, who in thanking Olaf, Andreas, Michele and Maria Grazia for the great job they did in really pulling this together and organizing this conference. Thank you. So last user meeting or user assembly in Lucerne in September last year, I announced the machine that we were going to build in the final details. And we didn't talk about the size at the time, but it turns out to be one of the couple of large systems along with the one in Jülich that we have in Europe. And it is a very energy efficient system. So it is among all the petascale systems in the world, according to a number of metrics that you can apply, the most energy efficient. And this turned out to be the most important feature, because ETH